Hi guys, welcome back to Guild Chat. I'm your host Rubi, and I have Leah and Liz with me today. I'm going to let you guys introduce yourselves, and then we can get into rhapsodizing about the launch trailer.
Excellent. Hi, I'm Leah Hoyer. I'm the head of narrative at ArenaNet.
And I'm Liz Kirstein. I'm part of the brand team.
Awesome. And you guys were both super involved in the making of the launch trailer. So let's kind of jump right in, because we have probably more to talk about than we have time for. And we've all three been sitting here while we were watching the launch trailer, just staring at it and smiling. We love it.
So, it's pretty cool.
Yeah, so this is kind of different than what we do for an episodic trailer, and I'll kind of let you go into that, Leah.
Absolutely. When we put our episodic trailers together, largely we pull them from clips, both from the previous episode as well as things we want to tease right. from the coming episode. And in this case, we wanted to do something really special. We wanted to go out. We wanted to try to...
We're telling a story.
Yeah, we really wanted to bring in a visual style, a kind of mood that encapsulates a lot of what we're trying to do with Heart of Thorns. And so that, you know, we absolutely decided we needed to go out, we needed to work with a trusted partner, we needed to just get all these really talented people together to create something special.
And Rubi, you said that we were trying to tell a story, which was absolutely the case, but I think one of the things we were very clear about in our early talks was that we didn't feel like we needed to tell you the whole story of expansion.
Right. Oh, absolutely.
We didn't have to tell you, oh, the Pact Fleet has crashed, and Mordremoth's forces are, you know, gaining power, and this is, everything's lost, and, like, tell you word for word what led up to this.
Yeah, we've done that. This is a little bit of a departure. It's a different story. Yeah,
for sure.
Absolutely. Because the other thing is... We obviously want to save most of the story for when people get the chance to play through the story.
So let's not spoil everything.
No, but really presenting, and I think it was a largely marketing's idea kind of early on, was let's talk about, I know, good
we do
job.
Have ideas.
Yeah.
was, and they're good.
It'd be so cool to do something that's maybe more from the villain's perspective. And if Mordremoth is there and we have a dragon who is talking to all of our Silvari and there's, you know, called them home, and what does that mean? And and could we get into the brain of...
Well, Mordremoth's point of view
and which I thought was a great starting point. And it took us down a whole bunch of different directions that could have gone. But
Leah, when we were working on dialogue, you had a lot of really cool insight into kind of Mordremoth not really having a personality in terms of, like, goals and ambitions.
Yes, and I think the very first line of the trailer is the one that we kind of started with. And as a narrative team, we go back to a lot, which is that I am this world.
Right.
Mordremoth and all the Elder Dragons really operate on kind of a different plane. They're not concerned about individual petty squabbles. They're not necessarily concerned about one person or one little faction that's doing something over there. They've got an agenda that is kind of natural to them to play out. And it's, you know, Mordremoth's point of view in this particular situation is always going to be just, of course people are going to follow me. I made them to follow me.
And this Mordremoth.
Yes. And he's so, or it is so built into the jungle that, and it really does, they are, in its mind, kind of one and the same. And the Elder Dragons and Tyri are kind of hard to separate from one another. And so really allowing that to have a voice became kind of the thing we played with in at least the opening segments of it. And then you get to see a little more of what some of the battle gets to be like and all of that.
Well, and this is something that you and I delved into a couple weeks ago. We talked about Mordremoth and just the Elder Dragons' agenda and how they're bigger than that. So that's it's
definitely
been an interesting avenue to explore.
It has been, and it's something that we, of course, will get into a lot more in Heart of Thorns. There's a lot more exposure to it, but that point of view and that sense that the things that individual residents of Tyria or even factions are worried about and concerning themselves, they're really quite different than what an Elder Dragon is going to concern itself with.
Yep.
And that gave us a really nice launch point for that.
Yeah. And Mordremoth saying, I am this world, is that plays into controlling all of these elements, controlling these vines, all of these vine creatures that we've been looking at are, it lends this element of it's everywhere, and anything that you're looking around at can be turned against you.
absolutely. The entire jungle, in many ways, is Mordremoth's plaything. It has the ability to use the plants, to use the creatures, to use the Silvari, who become Mordremguard, against, you know, the player character and against all of the Pact factions and our allies who are, you know, trying to put a stop to that and bring balance and bring peace to the jungle. But that's not, you know, doesn't really go hand in hand with kind of the way Mordremoth looks at the world.
Right.
The way Mordremoth is sort of gathering power and gathering minions and, you know, using them to sort of secure its base as, you know, an Elder Dragon.
Well, and I think if you've played Silvari characters during the Beta Weekends events, if you guys have played them during the Beta Weekends events, you hear Mordremoth in your ear.
Like, it is chilling.
Bringing you home. It's super creepy. Yeah, it's a neat little insight into what Mordremoth is doing and what Mordremoth can do.
Yeah, I do think it is one of the really cool, it's one of my favorite cool player experiences.
I love
it. The fact that if you play any other race, you're not going to hear that. But when you are playing Silvari, because you were made to be this dragon's minions, you have a special wired connection, and there's a voice going on in your head that is repeatedly going to come back and call you, tell you what's going on, tell you what it's doing, and give you that perspective, which is very cool.
Super neat.
Yeah. There's a theme underlying here, too. I mean, we've talked about how Mordremoth, I like the way you said the jungle is its plaything. I mean, this is all out there. You've got the Mordremguard that you and I talked about a little while ago.
Yes.
And there's also, we talked some about this theme of free will versus what is your destiny. And it was a good parallel between the Nightmare Court and the Mordremguard and why the Nightmare Court don't just blindly follow Mordremoth.
Yeah.
But there's this struggle going on about your free will is not your own.
Yeah, and that's really brought up in the trailer in that segment right after the vines opening when you have the Mordremguard and Ritlock kind of locked swords in there, you know, that kind of all will serve the jungle dragon. Yeah.
Yeah,
and that response of we serve no one is... It very much plays out the difference in this and really a thematic struggle that underlies the entire Heart of Thorns. And so that for us was a really important moment to make sure we put in the trailer.
Yeah.
Like Liz was saying before, we're not trying to tell the whole story, but we are trying to tell the kind of themes and the real sense of it. And that is really core, obviously, to the Silvari character player experience, but also just in general to what does it mean to be a minion? What does it mean to have been created for this? What in certain things, if you are born into a certain race, if you're born into a certain village, are there certain things about your destiny that are kind of written for you, or do you really have the chance to step outside of that? And we play with that, not just in the Silvari story, but in a variety of other things. And it was important to us then to bring in that message and to talk about how, no, myself and my team, we're going to take this on. We're not going to take this, you know, standing down. We're going to absolutely rise up, defend, look for something beyond just a destiny and be able to make our own course.
Yeah. And all of this struggle feeds into the story that we told in the launch trailer. How did you guys even begin to get all of this funneled into...
Gosh. So back in like April, we were writing the original business requirements doc and creative brief for this. Mm-hmm. And we basically sent it to the partner we were working with, Axis, and said, you know, pitch us some ideas that capture a couple of these ideas. Here's some thoughts we've had, but we really wanted to see what they could bring to the table.
Yep.
And they sent back, I think, 8 proposals. And we were like, okay, so the first 6 are all right. You know, they're nice. They tell good stories. Yeah. We really like the last 2. Can we kind of focus in on those? And we went through a couple rounds with them. They actually had some really cool ideas that never actually made it to fruition, but kind of carry through in bits and pieces. Like, one of the coolest ones in my mind was they had this idea of just showing a bunch of vignettes of tiny moments in time made entirely with vines, and obviously some of that motif carried through. We mm-hmm. have that entire opening scene of, you know, the dragon eye and then wing and then claw. But they were like, just, we're going to show it all over Tyrion, this and that. And we're like, well, that's not quite right, but it's got something. And the other one wasn't quite right, but it had something. And so we just kind of probably drove them a little up the wall, just going back and being like, can we have a little more of merging them together? And, you know, we're obviously thrilled with the final result. It's been super nice to watch it come together like it has.
Yeah, that whole vines motif was something that we played around with for a while. We did a lot of visual development on it. And what does that mean to have vines kind of representing Mordremoth's power and coming to life and taking such shape over things mm-hmm. and playing around with what should those look like? How should the shape of that come together?
Yeah.
That was something we actually spent a lot of our visual development on working into that to make sure it felt right as well. And
yeah, because I mean that opening scene is so abstract that if they couldn't have quite nailed it, it could have just been kind of catastrophic and just kind of plants moving across the screen, and it ultimately ended up being, you know, both beautiful visually and I feel, you know, very narratively consistent. And you're saying, okay, like clearly this is a wing, clearly this is something else, and you have the VO that's, you know, saying I am this world, and it all kind of ultimately worked together the way we were hoping it would.
Yeah, really the I am this world was about the only line that we kind of gave to them,
and then we
went back and forth on where should the rest of this lie. And as frequently happens when you're working with anything animated, but your script and your visuals and all of it really do evolve together, and it became a really nice partnership. I mean, working with them has really been excellent. They were such a great partner. They're actually based out of Scotland.
Mm-hmm.
I had worked really closely with them mm-hmm. once before because they are the same people who brought us the what we refer to as the story trailer that played at the end of episode 8 of season 2. Yeah.
And this is Axis we're talking about, by
the
way.
Yes, and Axis is, they were part of that where you have Kate saying, it's true, there is a dragon egg, and you sort of see glimpses of things, but it was done in a very more of a representational form,
right.
And in this one we played much more with, obviously not quite photorealistic, there was a
right.
really nice style and stuff to it, but that had a very distinct style to it, and we loved the way that they brought cool life to that, and that when we gave them more of a script,
yeah.
and I worked with them a lot on stuff and the marketing team, and we'd focused on that, and they were such an easy partner to work with, and we really loved how they brought something that I think a lot of people responded to really positively, and we were like, well, could they step it up, do even more kind of fully rendered CG big action sequences that were there, and let's see how this goes. And wow.
Yeah, they really delivered. And I mean, we were there with them every step of the way. For 5 months, we've had kind of weekly phone calls with them. I remember the first time they delivered, kind of the first time that we saw not just a bunch of placeholder, but there was actually some, you know, final textures, maybe final lightings. And we were supposed to have a 30-minute call with them. And I think I had to leave after 90 minutes. Daniel and Phil were just going frame by frame, like, you know, scene by scene and shot by shot, but just being like, okay, we're on this frame. This is what we really love. You know, do this everywhere that you can, and you know, this could still use a little tweaking in this direction, and just, you know, providing constant feedback and constant, like, this is up to our standard, this still has room to grow sort of thing.
Totally. It seems all the way along they've been really willing. I mean, they were as eager to make something great as we were, and they were just really willing to do whatever it took to make that happen.
Definitely. And with a game like ours that obviously is known so much for its visual style and how beautiful the game is, and you know, Daniel and his team really do deliver.
Yeah, the baseline is like way up there.
Time after time, and so, you know, the fact that they worked so closely together and we could leverage the talents within ArenaNet, working with them and kind of going back and forth and looking at what are some of, you know, our internal, we shared with them some of our internal thinking on like Mordremoth and vines and other things like that, and then gave them a real sort of, here's some inspiration,
right.
but do something beyond this, because this doesn't need to be, you don't need to be confined necessarily to things that we've thought about with a lot of those visuals. And they loved it. Like,
yeah.
they just took that and ran with it, and they'd come back, we'd give some thoughts and comments on, oh, this actually quite it won't work because of this story reason or this particular thing, but in the end, there was a big back and forth that really worked.
That vine monster at the very end was kind of a later addition to the script. It was going to be originally just kind of the wyvern falling off, but we felt we needed kind of menace to come back. And they were like, we don't know what you want this thing to look like. You know, you've told us big and huge and made of vines. And we sent them some concept art.
Yeah.
And Daniel was like, just kind of use this for inspiration. Mm-hmm. And they sent back something that took a couple key elements, but was so totally their own thing. And, you know, he was going back and saying, okay, now more mandibles, and more tongue sort of thing. But, you know, they were really good at taking our concept art and saying, okay, these are the key elements, these are the key defining features of it, and kind of growing it from there and making it something their own.
Mm-hmm. I think it worked out well, because we had that moment where Ritlock takes down the wyvern and, you know, it goes up, and which is an amazing moment in and of itself. I mean, it just tells the story of here's what this revenant is doing. You know, he takes it down, takes his sword, and he's like, we're done here.
Yeah.
And you have this in the back of your head, are you really done here?
That ominous moment when the vines all start kind of receding back.
And the ground is trembling just a tad.
So good.
Yeah, it is. They have done really, really good work. Mm-hmm. So I actually wanted to ask you, since you are the head of narrative, how difficult was it to figure out, okay, this is exactly the story we want to tell out of all the stories we could tell that are coming into Heart of Thorns, and we just want to give a little clip and not give everything away? How do you pick one?
Well, I think we did spend a lot of time on that, but that sense of when you really do focus down on, okay, one central core theme is that sense of, okay, there is a villain who has a real sense of destiny, and there are you as the player, and very much when we were looking at this, wanted to think about the player character, and what is the player character point of view that contrasts with the Mordremoth point of view, and I think the more we played around with that, the more we actually were like, that moment of, you know, hey, here's this one attitude, but our attitude is always going to be able to rebel against that. It just kind of clicked. I think a lot of that fell into it. And again, it's not like those are the only things that we wanted to cover with this. Obviously, Ritlock was chosen very much for a reason, because Ritlock's our first revenant, and we still absolutely are very excited about talking about this new profession that you get to play that is so awesome,
kind of his story with it.
And seeing how powerful that character can be, and you know, having the team there kind of at the end to back it up. I mean, they are all sort of out fighting on this space as well, but having that sense of, okay, when you are playing this game, it very much mirrors the way we know so much of Heart of Thorns is about bringing our guilds together, bringing player teamwork, bringing camaraderie together too. But it always does when you are playing your game, it comes down to you.
You matter.
You know, you're the one who's doing something. And, and we also really wanted to build that up as well. The sense of, okay, one person makes a difference, but one person working with their team. And we actually had a lot of internal discussion about when the Mordremguard has that moment where it says, all will serve the jungle dragon.
Yes.
And it was sort of, okay, well, here's Ritlock. Should Ritlock say, we really went back and forth on this. Should Ritlock say, I serve no one?
Yeah.
Or should he say, we serve no one?
Yeah.
And really, at the end of the day, when we thought about it a little more, we were like, it's we. It's all of us. He isn't just speaking for himself or the player character. It's for all the player characters. Yep. And it's for you and your guild or your friends that you play with all the time, or the ones that you just meet with and you get to go attack the bosses together. Like, that is such a great part of our game. And one of the things that all of the people who play our game kind of universally love, the fact that teamwork is so encouraged, not just in guilds, and obviously it's going to be in raids and in a lot of our challenging content, but by everything that we've designed our game to do, it's so much about the team. And so that moment too was a really core central piece of it that we wanted to make sure that was clear, and featuring some of the cool things that the jungle can throw at you and that the jungle dragon can throw at you. So there is a kind of one central maybe theme that goes through it, but it gave us the opportunity to put all those other pieces in it and kind of make a, what really at the end of the day is less about telling one central story and more about telling the mood and the vibe of the game.
Absolutely.
Yeah. So, yeah.
And I think if we can speak to that moment for just a second, when Ritlock is in that combat situation and it's, you know, it's come down to it, the swords are together and he's telling you, you will serve the jungle dragon. Mm-hmm. And I think even that tiny little turn of phrase, like you guys talked about, I versus we, speaks so much to what we want to do and transitions so perfectly into the kind of gameplay that we encourage, that it's great seeing that we took it right down to that tiny little two-letter word and the attention to detail that we paid. I feel like it came out really well and it paid off. All of those weekly meetings. How hard was it to leave that meeting after 90 minutes?
I was like, oh no, I really gotta go to another thing.
Can everybody wait until I can come back?
But it was really cool. So obviously we were working with kind of a lot of placeholders early on.
Right.
And you're just seeing a lot of things that could be really cool one day. But right now, you know, I think Daniel was calling them spiny cucumbers for a long time, just the placeholder vines.
I was laughing. You told me about that like a week or two ago and I could not, I can't unsee it
and
now
like,
when I look at the placeholder
stuff. You know
where
it's going and you know it's going to be cool, but you aren't seeing that yet. And I was gone for a couple weeks around Gamescom and I came back and that was the first time that this was the same instance when they kind of first handed over a lot of stuff that wasn't placeholder anymore and had textures and lighting and all that.
Yeah.
And you just saw everyone in the room just like... Like, I think that dust scene when the Wyvern is kind of toppling over him going on the edge,
yeah,
that was
that
in there basically
is
final.
Amazing.
And just everyone's just jaw is dropping.
Okay.
And Daniel looked over and he's got this like cherubic smile on his face and he's like, it's gonna be awesome.
Oh,
and just
man.
This feeling of immense relief as you're like, they can pull it off, we can pull it off. Like, you know, the story's coming together, the visuals are coming together, and it was so rewarding.
Yeah. And we have some recorded footage from Daniel and Phil in just a few minutes, but that was the thing Daniel talked about, how completely nervous he was turning this over to an outside force, and it's like, you know, okay, this is my baby. Treat it well.
Yeah.
Do it well. You guys have done amazing work.
Oh,
you guys have
well,
done
thanks.
Amazing work.
Obviously, there were so many people within the company.
Oh, absolutely.
And,
yeah.
Yeah,
we haven't even touched
the
sound
entire
design.
Access studio that worked on it as well, and, you know, our voice acting and everything, you know, really.
Yeah.
The moving pieces that go in to make the, you know, something that it's
so intricate.
Yes, it's yeah. It really is a it, but the team, and especially because Axis, it's not like Axis is down the street,
right?
Axis is in Scotland, and so all of these calls that we're talking about were at 9 a.m. because they're, of course,
right?
You
our
know,
9 a.m. there, 4 or 5 or
right.
Whatever.
So you're just trying to meet someplace when everybody's in the office,
yes, and trying to iterate on things quickly, watch things as a group so that we can actually give them cohesive feedback. I mean, it takes a lot, but I'm super happy with it.
Yeah.
I do want to say
gorgeous.
Before we end that the sound design on this was also a really key component. James Ackley and McLean, who's been here playing live music, just did an incredible job on it. I'd
They're
seen
amazing.
All the final visuals, but I hadn't heard the final audio yet. And when I didn't see it until the actual like stage version render. And like you'd never heard the chuckle before. There'd never been the music in there. And even as someone who had seen this, you know, weekly multiple times, it was chilling. I had like shivers. I was like, oh,
it really
my
was.
Gosh, we made this.
Yeah. Well, then why don't we finish up by seeing what Daniel and Phil had to say? Let's take a look at that video, and we will wrap up with that.
Excellent.
Seems like a good note to end on. Thank you, guys.
Bye.
We were looking at creating a trailer for our expansion that would be visually impactful, that would give us the emotional response from the players.
We first initially talked to Axis about doing the trailer with us 3.5, almost 4 months ago.
It was the first time we have successfully accomplished such a collaboration with an external studio.
We made sure that we looped our audio director in so that he could really plan the sound design out for this video. James Ackley, our audio designer, and McLean Deemer, our composer, worked together to, you know, come up with a something that was cohesive with the visuals. It wasn't just a musical score that he was going to lay sound effects over the top of. It really works together. They did a great job with it, and were, you know, pretty integral to the process. Access provided us with a bunch of ideas. We iterated on that a lot. We had several discussions with them talking about what we wanted to accomplish.
It was, for me personally, kind of an unnerving experience always, to, you know, every step of the way early on, kind of taking a leap of faith and hoping that the storyboards that and animatics that we're looking at will eventually translate in beautifully rendered art pieces, moving paintings.
And then we went through a series of animatics, 2D animatics, 3D animatics, concept art. They did vertical slice, which gives us an idea of what the final outcome will look like.
Guys at Axis really over-delivered and truly captured the essence of our art style.
They provided us with drops at least once a week, lots of times twice a week, so we could approach it from the sense of the whole video and all the story that's told through the video, and also for what the final look was going to be. It was fun to listen to Daniel give feedback on these shots, because it was literally like listening to him give feedback to a concept artist.
It is truly a handcrafted piece as far as the attention to detail that went into it.